You may have noticed that our YouTube channel got hacked into last week. YouTube was actually one of four hacking incidents, and none of them were a result of a phishing attack where you click a link or by downloading a file containing malware. Nor did the hackers know our usernames or passwords. First, my husband's Facebook account that owns our company page was hacked into, but we were able to stop that before they did any damage. Then his LinkedIn account had the language changed to Chinese and the profile picture changed, which was all they could do without the password. On YouTube, they were able to change the channel name, remove all our videos, and start live streaming a crypto interview. Their goal was to get you to click on a link they'd put in the comments that takes you to their website, where they would con you into investing in their scam. And lastly, our credit card details were stolen, and they tried to buy some crazy expensive stuff, which I'll come back to. So how did this happen? Well, we have three PCs that could have been attacked, two at home and a laptop. We've ruled out phones because they didn't have access to YouTube and the credit card that was stolen wasn't in the Apple wallet. All PCs have antivirus and all have been scanned with another antivirus program to double check they weren't infected. The hackers did not have our logon, email addresses or passwords. We know that because they were limited to perform actions that didn't require them. And we can see from the YouTube security activity that they didn't log in. So if they didn't log in, how did they manage to get in? Well, I was alerted that something might be up with YouTube when I woke up just after midnight, and I noticed that I hadn't put my phone on the charging stand. When I picked it up, I saw two-step verification requests from Google, followed by 11 more notifications, one of which said that a new email address had been added to my account 8 minutes ago. Now, my phone is set to silent, so I was 8 minutes too late to do anything about it, but I suspect all the light coming from the notifications might have been what eventually woke me up. Luckily, I hadn't also put my eye mask on that night. The other notifications informed me they had changed the recovery phone number, changed the password, turned off my two-step verification, added a security key, and removed my recovery email and phone numbers. I rushed to my PC and confirmed I could no longer access my YouTube account and all my videos were gone. Now, frustratingly, all the Google documentation online tells you to log into your account to recover it, but that's only possible if the hacker hasn't removed your email address, which of course is one of the first things they did. Unsurprisingly, Google don't give you a phone number you can call or even a contact form. It literally took hours to find a way to contact Google and get proper help, all while changing passwords on other accounts. And I'm not gonna lie, there were moments where I didn't think we'd get the channel back. I eventually managed to contact them through another Google account that I have, and they shared a link to a questionnaire that I could complete to notify them of the hijacking. But by this time, it's 4:30 a.m. and I decided there wasn't much more I could do but wait for Google to sort it out. I didn't even want to think about what I'd do if we lost everything. A few hours later, I woke to loads of messages, texts, emails and LinkedIn messages, etc. from our fabulous community alerting me to the hacking. I'm so grateful for your support. It's just reassuring to know that you had our back through it all. I also had an email from Google acknowledging the account had been hijacked, and they were working on recovering it. The hacker had used a Gmail address for the account login. Rookie error. So Google simply handed me control of that account. I checked the hacker's emails and I could see that one of the first things they did was change the account the payments go to. To be honest, I'd be disappointed in their hacking abilities if they didn't do that. Now, at this stage, I've got access to the Google account that now owns my channel, but my channel's been suspended due to the spammy content they posted. So getting it back completely is still a way off. I spent the next hour or so restoring my security measures so they couldn't get back in, and that's when I get a bit more of an insight into the hackers' movements. I can see I last signed into my account on January 24th. This was on a new laptop we'd taken on vacation that had no prior browsing history, no passwords or credit cards saved to it. I never do that anyway. Then, on February 1st, the hacker added a recovery email. Notice they haven't logged in. Now, at this time of night, the laptop and our PCs are turned off, so they aren't remotely accessing a PC logged in to YouTube. One explanation for how they were able to access the account without logging in is via a session token. A session token is a temporary, randomly generated piece of data for authentication and authorization during a single session on a web app. They're designed to allow you to browse the site, perform various actions without having to constantly keep logging in every time you navigate to a different page on their site. Now, they're typically short-lived, becoming invalid after the session ends. Sites like banks end their tokens quite quickly, usually in a few minutes. but other sites like YouTube, Facebook, and LinkedIn can allow these tokens to persist for days or even months. Hackers can get hold of these session tokens and use them to access your account without needing the email address or password. This begs the question, how they got the session token? A common way they do this is by tricking you into opening an executable file that contains some malware. But we're very confident we didn't open any files like this, and remember, the scan of all our devices that accessed our YouTube account didn't have any evidence of a virus. Another way they can access your PC is over insecure Wi-Fi. And this is the most likely route they took because we recently stayed in an Airbnb in France and used their Wi-Fi, as well as Wi-Fi in the British Airways Business Lounge in Geneva Airport. Session hijack attacks are usually carried out against busy networks with a high number of active communication sessions. This provides the attacker with a large volume of sessions to exploit and gives them a measure of protection because the number of active sessions on the server makes them less likely to be detected. This was definitely the case in the British Airways lounge with every other person on a laptop. They can then impersonate the user to launch a new web session, which means that the user does not have to be logged in at the time. This might explain YouTube, Facebook, and LinkedIn because these accounts were accessed via Wi-Fi, but it doesn't explain how the credit card was stolen. On the Saturday, it was used to purchase $30,500 worth of jewelry, which thankfully I was able to stop straight away. But that didn't deter them from attempting 13 more times to purchase everything from takeout to fancy car wheels. All purchases were attempted from Australian sites in various Australian cities on the East Coast. Now, we live in Queensland, and it appears the hacker knows this because when they logged into YouTube, they were identified as logging in from Queensland, Australia. And they do this by using a VPN to make it look like they were logging in from here. For those who don't know, a VPN, short for Virtual Private Network, is a secure network connection that allows you to access the internet while masking your true IP address and therefore location. So if the breach happened on our laptop in France or Switzerland via a compromised Wi-Fi connection, how did they get my credit card details, which weren't on the laptop? We know the card wasn't skimmed because the card they used had a February 2024 expiry date, and I'd already shredded the physical card with that expiry date when I received my new card before we went away. And the card in my Apple Wallet on my phone was also already updated to the new card. This most likely means they must have somehow got my old credit card details from a browser or one of the online stores I'd used the card in had been compromised. But given the timing of events, it's most likely my browser. By the way, my browser was Edge. And this is the mystery because we checked all our browsers and none of them store the credit card details, which means one of the sites I purchased from does not securely encrypt the credit card details when I entered them in a form. And they've obviously managed to somehow extract them from the browser history. Now, I'm not a network security expert, so if you have an alternate theory on how they got the credit card number, please share it in the comments. So how do you prevent this happening to you? Firstly, avoid public Wi-Fi. I'm fortunate to have a large data allowance on my phone plan. When I travel, I can use my phone for $5 a day as though I'm at home. So I can use my own phone as a Wi-Fi hotspot. Of course, this will drain your phone battery quicker, which is why I use the Wi-Fi at the airport. So be sure to have a backup battery pack if you can't plug your phone in to charge. If for whatever reason you can't use your phone, use a VPN so that data sent over a Wi-Fi network is encrypted and can't be intercepted by hackers. Log out of your accounts when you're not using them. If they do somehow access your PC, this will at least reduce the session IDs that they can get hold of to only those that are active at the time. And it's not always enough to just close the tab. You must make sure you actually log out. Of course, make sure you have active antivirus software. And if you have a Google account, make sure you have all the sign-in options and two-factor verification options enabled. And preferably, use Gmail account. This way, if hackers do remove your email address, you can still access Google support. A quick note to our customers, just to let you know that none of our systems or customer data were compromised. We don't capture or store customer data anyway. This is all done by our merchant services, Stripe or PayPal. Thanks for watching. Stay safe.